Things have been moving abundantly slow out here in the gallery as of late, and I don't know if it's the atmosphere of what's going on in the world today, or I just don't want to do anything else but play with this aquarium and look at it, and I feel like I can't top it. I am absolutely infatuated with this. This is my favorite aquarium right now. And I know I say that every time, but it is. There has been some new fish added to the tank and some things changed. Of course, when I come near the tank, everybody wants to hide. But luckily, I already got footage of all of you guys and I got you feeding. We're gonna talk about them eating. We're gonna talk about maintenance. We're gonna talk about the changes. And of course, what fish we ended up adding to the tank thus far. So you guys will remember we had 7 yellow tangs in this tank. We had 2 hippo tangs, which is also known as the hippo tang, the regal tang, and the blue tang. Call it what you like. I like calling it a hippo tang because, I don't know, I just like that name. Just rolls off to the lips a little bit easier than the rest of them. I also already had in a purple tang, which is a notorious bully, but he's got to be one of the most interesting fish in here because he's always interacting with the yellow tangs, and I don't think he knows who's who because everybody's in perfect condition, but he's always fighting, but not really, mostly tail slapping and trying to stick them with their spines. If you don't know, every one of these tangs have these little spines at the base of their tail that they use to lodge themselves into crevices and not be able to come out, and they also use it for fighting. Really interesting. This is a tank I could watch for hours. Just gorgeous. The colors are popping. It's just, the fish aren't even that yeah, they are. We're gonna get to it. It's just a little different than fresh water. We also already had in here, what else did we have in there? We had the 7 tangs, we had the 2 hippos, we had the purple tang, we had the 2 blue spotted stingrays, and I think that was it. Everybody keeps hiding right now, so it's a little difficult to keep track. But then we added in the fox face. We also added in the tomini, or the, I like to call it the flame tail tang. We also added in the sailfin tang, who's gonna be gorgeous when they grow up. Yeah, we got a lot of tangs in this tank. But then we also added in, oh, you know who else was in here? He just poked his face out. The clown trigger. Yeah, I watched him spike right up earlier today. Turned into a complete triangle for a couple of seconds. One of the rays ticked him off a little bit. And we also added in the Stars and Stripes puffer, who we named Kevin. Now, when I added these guys all in, I forgot to turn on the audio, and I was naming them all when they came in, when I was putting them in the tank. It was absolutely hilarious, but forgot to turn on that, so whatever. Now they're all nameless, but deep in my heart, they all have a name. And these fish are so common and so easy to keep and relatively affordable in comparison, yet they're so vibrant and colorful and just popping. And they're getting nice and fat as well. The regal tangs, or the hippo tangs as I like to call them, have doubled in size. The yellow tangs are nice and fat, nice thick foreheads. They're looking really good. The rays are putting on size. We'll get to all that here in a few minutes. However, one of the things that I found fascinating, there's a few things that happened, especially with the puffer, when we added him. Mind you, he might be getting moved, potentially. We'll see how you guys feel about it. Let me show you something. We might be moving him to this saltwater tank that we previously set up. I would say that it's almost fully cycled. I mean, a couple more days, if I added him in right now, I'd probably have to do a water change tomorrow and then we're good to go. One fish inside that. I'm contemplating it because the idea struck me. What if we went freshwater or saltwater puffer and freshwater puffer? We got Tyrese, the Fajaca puffer, right here beside him. If you guys aren't following me on Instagram, I post videos of him all the time and lots of other fish and tanks and feeding videos, including the saltwater, the everything. I have a lot of fun there. So follow me on there if you're not already, because sometimes we go live and we have a lot of fun. Sometimes we even get ourselves into trouble. Anyways, that's an idea that struck me to potentially put him in that tank, and then we have the really fun comparison. Be honest with you, I wanna know, because they can see each other through the tanks. The tanks are side by side. I wanna see if they like each other, maybe attack each other, maybe I have to put some cardboard in between them. I don't know. What do you guys think would happen if they meet for the freshwater and a saltwater puffer that we could never possibly meet in the wild ever, meet for the first time? Do they speak the same language? Would they be mad at each other? Would they show different coloration? What do you guys think would happen there? Let me know in the comment section below. when we added the puffer fish in. Ooh, what an interesting thing that happened next. So he went down into this corner. You guys like to call it my little tornado corner. You can see like the substrate's moving around a little bit, which we added a little substrate. We're gonna talk about that in a minute. I know I need a haircut. I look horrible. The tornado's caused by the Ecotec wave maker there. Anyways, should we talk about the sand first? Okay, let's talk about sand first. I'm gonna be all over in this video for a couple of reasons. This tank really, really excites me right now. It's really exciting to show. It's my favorite right now. Yeah, it's a tough competition, just a sec. This bad boy, 700 gallons with freshwater stingrays. We've got the black diamonds, we've got pearls. Let me adjust the lighting here a little bit. We've got a giant gourami. Look at the size of Susan now. We've got an Asian arowana that's pushing 2 feet, if not more. We've got three vieja, I believe to be a male and two females, but time will tell. We even put in the walrus. All of them are in there. Look at this little guy. There's Timmy. You guys see him? Let me adjust it. Timmy's the smallest little runt walrus where he's actually put on a little bit of size. With the black bottom, these guys are darkening up a little bit more. Anyways, when it's feeding time, he runs the tank. It's absolutely hilarious. We'll have to do a feeding video. Well, you can go find me on Instagram and see it there. We've got some clown loaches in here. We've got a sunshine pleco. Am I missing anybody else? I don't think so. This all used to be piled over in the corner there, and the rays move it around, literally. Anyways, back to the main video. We added sand to the tank. Now, at first I was against it. I had a 40 pounds in a bucket, basically just a bucket of crushed coral and sand combination type of deal. Very typical of what you'd find in a saltwater aquarium. I thought two things about it. I was like, well, I can add it and it's going to cause two things. One, the puffer might not look as good in it with the light substrate. He might lighten up in coloration because he's gonna wanna blend in a little bit. And he did, arguably, but bang, his belly looks fantastic. Isn't that gorgeous? The other fish, of course, ended up looking way better. We also have more light reflection coming off of the substrate, and because of that, I don't have to have the lights as bright as they typically will, so less energy consumption, less algae issues. It's about a quarter of an inch everywhere, and I did it as a test. I figured, you know what, worst case scenario, the rays are going to push it all to the center on each end. We're going to have one little bar of sand all the way through the tank, and that's a huge reason why I don't like to add sand. The other reason, of course, is it can potentially cause water quality issues. The raised barbs can get stuck in it and or lost in it. It's more difficult for them to find their food. What I found with it, the only side effect with the rays is they're less active with the substrate. Far less active without with the substrate in there. A lot of times they sit on it, hide on it, but there's one under here, one over here. Other than that, these guys are doing pretty good, and it is only about a quarter of an inch. I don't have to vacuum it, nothing like that, but you can see what they do here. They spend most of their time here because this is where I feed. When they're hungry, they're here, and then when they swim up and it pushes back, swims up, pushes it back. This tiny little amount isn't that bad, and I do like it. A lot of you guys liked it as well that follow me on Instagram. You guys know that I've been posting pictures and videos and whatnot. I just haven't really talked about it. I did do a 24-hour, it might have been even like 36-hour, lights on period. I wanted to do that right before a water change so I can grow algae all over these rocks and make them look the way they do. Far more natural than they once did. So if we look, here's one that doesn't really have any algae on it. It's still got that purple look to it, which looks good if you can keep it like that. But ideally, I like this a lot better. So this is just a little bit of an algae coating. Which in the long run, if I can grow it and get the right species growing on it, all the tangs are going to graze on it nonstop, which in the end is great for them because they are constant grazers. So once the puffer was added, we're going to get back to that, he goes over to the corner right here. The rays follow him over. Unfortunately, I didn't catch this on camera. The rays, of course, we know are venomous. And what do rays do to show they're venomous? This doesn't really happen in fresh water, even though there's tons of spotted freshwater rays, I've never seen any of them do it. Let me explain what they did. So this is the male, the smaller of the two, not as plump as the female. Still working on getting these guys plumped up, but I gotta tell you, their appetites are not as voracious or whatever that word is, as freshwater rays. Okay, we'll just use this girl. So you can see her blue spots. they have those blue spots as a warning in the saltwater side of things. A lot of the times, even the blue ring stink or the blue ring octopus is very similar. They use these spots as a warning. So when they cornered the puffer, well, the puffer wasn't cornered. He actually comes over here. Look at him there. Kevin, come over here for a sec, bro. Just to, like, let's recreate it. He was over here. The rays came over. They didn't see him at first because he was sitting still. But as soon as they touched him, they took the back half of their disc up and displayed it like a peacock. Like, look at me. I'm poisonous. Don't hurt me or I will hurt you. Absolutely incredible. Nothing was happening. It was just a warning. Like, hey, don't mess with me. Because the next day or two, the puffer was nipping, not at his tail, at her tail. And she has a few little nip marks. It didn't happen ever since, and she's healing up just fine. She's probably about 50% now. Nothing damaging. It is nothing where she would feel it. It's kind of like having a fish's fins nipped. But yeah, she's fine now. But that was the only thing that I noticed. Also about the puffer. So we know puffer fish puff up. Why do they do it? They do it for a couple of reasons. One is, of course, it's a self-defense mechanism where they puff up, they suck in a bunch of water and triple their body size to appear larger to their prey than they actually are. And or sometimes they do it when they get into a prey's mouth, they blow up so they can't be swallowed. These are videos out there captured in the wild seeing this happening all the time. But a puffer can't just puff up randomly. They do it when they're threatened and or are displaying to another fish. But in the home aquarium, if none of those things are happening and they're not stressed, he's clearly not stressed. He eats out of my hands if you watch those videos. Even my Fahaka Tyrese does it. Every once in a while, you'll catch them out of the corner of your eye puffing up. Why are they doing this? They need to stretch their bodies to continuously being able to do this. So it's not necessarily something they do every day. Maybe they do, but we're not seeing it or being able to capture it on film. But anyways, the last video I made it right here. I look over and I see him slowly start to puff up. I spin the camera around and I see him puff up all the way. It was absolutely fascinating to see. And then of course he relieves it all. Why did he do this? Just stretching out, making sure that he could still do it. Because stretching obviously is painful, of course, and it is stressful, but if they continuously do it all the time, it becomes more easier for them to do it. So yeah, I was just glad I was able to capture that on camera and show you guys. Anyways, let's move on. What do we feed these guys? How often do we feed? What do they eat, et cetera, et cetera? Okay, so we have a variety of needs in this tank. The puffer needs shells, it needs crustaceans, it needs to cut down on its beak a little bit. Not at this size, but when he gets bigger, it's certainly going to become an issue. So I do feed him clams on the shell at times. He'll get chopped up shrimp. He'll eat anything that's offered to the other fish, including pellets if they're big enough for him to show any interest. But this tank does get tiny little marine pellets as well as flakes. It also gets minced up frozen food that has pretty much a variety of everything in it. They'll also get dried out seaweed on a veggie clip stuck to the side. It usually takes them about 10-20 minutes to eat the whole thing, but if they don't, I just take it out. Other times I'll leave it in if I'm, you know, not going to be able to feed them the next day, if I got to go somewhere or something like that. That hasn't happened as of late. And then the rays, of course, just get chopped up shrimp. They'll get mussels. They'll get clams. They'll get anything that I can give them. But what I'm trying to focus on is making sure that they're getting a high caloric diet at least a couple of times a day to fatten them up. But again, I'm finding that they eat a little bit and they just don't eat as much as the freshwater rays. And I think that I need to approach these guys in an entirely different way. Just because they're a member of the Elasmo branch doesn't mean I have experience with all of them. Got over a decade with freshwater rays, but the only experience I have with hands-on experience with saltwater rays is what you guys have seen so far, like a couple months or something, more 3 months or something. So all fish are in, everybody's doing absolutely fantastic. What do I do to take care of this tank? Would you believe me if I said it's pretty much identical to my freshwater tanks? I think that's been a huge aspect of what I'm trying to do here, is show you a really cool looking tank. And it doesn't have to be awesome. I mean, not a lot of people love this skate, but I gotta tell you, it's doing everything I said it would. The fish are hiding. Remember I said all this, the fish are gonna be hiding in it, darting in between it. They're able to go all throughout the cave systems. The rays can go all through it. The rays swim over it. They go around it. It's a perfect scape for these fish. For now, I'm probably going to have to change some things in the near future. But for maintenance, I gotta tell you, I don't have to do anything with the substrate. There's just so little there. that I don't have to do anything, and plus the circulation in the tanks, removing anything that collects on the bottom and sending it to the overflow. I mean, sometimes I'll remove some built-up algae off of the front panel here, but when it comes to a water change, I change about 50 gallons once a week or every other week, clean the sumps, pre-filter, empty the skimmer. It's identical to fresh water minus the skimmer, but the skimmer, I literally just dump the cup and that's it. So is a saltwater aquarium difficult? I wouldn't say so. I mean, I'm running everything identical as to the way when this was set up as a freshwater tank. I'm even using the same filter, doing the same thing. We got the pre-filter for mechanical, then it runs through biological, and then it's returned to the main aquarium via the pump. The only difference is I added a skimmer. It's not even sized for this tank. I had it. I said, you know, why not? Let's just toss it on. Very low energy consumption. It's not going to hurt. And it is removing a lot of protein from the tank and helping with water quality. But ultimately, this setup is identical to the previous setup. The only difference here is instead of having fresh water, I've got salt in there. Doing a water change once a week would probably cost about $20 a week on this size tank. That's 375 gallons. It's 8 feet long, it's 3 feet front to back, and it's 2 feet tall, a little more than 2 feet tall. 125 gallon sump, 500 gallon system. So it can get expensive for water changes the way I'm doing it, but you can also invest in a ton of equipment and other things that can work on nutrient export to cut down on those water changes, and we'll move to that shortly.
To do my water change, I take this, like, I think it's about 60 gallon barrel. Where are you? I take this 60 gallon barrel, I fill it up with fresh water.
I fill it up to a predetermined height of that barrel where I know it's 50 gallons exactly.
Then I take a box of this Fritz salt. Now the Fritz salt comes in, this is a box of, it'll mix 200 gallons of salt water. Each bag has enough salt in it to mix 50 gallons of salt. So I guess you guys know what I do. I fill that barrel up, I dump this in, get it mixed up,
and I have my salt water, almost the perfect salinity every time. Sometimes I gotta add a little more salt, sometimes I gotta add a little bit more water, but I think I've only had to do that once or twice. And it was because I was being picky.
Suck some water out of this tank, about 50 gallons worth, pump the fresh stuff in, I'm done.
But yeah, I hope you guys can understand now why I really like this tank. It's super simple to take care of, it's super flashy. Like, anybody that comes in here, friends and family and whatnot, well, not anymore, not lately, but they all love this tank, and I can't blame them. Beautiful fish, amazing contrast, incredibly active when I'm not standing over here with these bright lights and, you know, waving my arms around like the lunatic I am in my videos. But absolutely gorgeous. We got that fox face there. I always forget which ones I'm talking about. But yeah, we got the seven yellow tangs, the purple tang, the puffer, we got the sail fin, we got the clown trigger, we got the fox face, we got the two hippos, we've got the two blue spotted stingrays as well. All the fish aren't in this tank either. There's other fish that are still over in quarantine that aren't ready to come over here. Either I want to get them a little more healthier, or, you know, get them eating a little bit better, or accepting the food that I'm offering, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. A number of reasons there's still fish in quarantine that are coming here shortly. So if you've seen an unboxing and they're not in this tank just yet, that's where they are, no big deal.
Yeah, I gotta say though, that this is a big tank with a bunch of little fish in comparison and in contrast.
In time, I'll definitely have to be looking into nutrient export, whether it's a refugium or some sort of reactor. We'll cross that bridge when we get to it. But what I wanted to do here is set up a super simple tank, running it just like a freshwater, which may not be the best way, but it's certainly a way you can get your feet wet. And learn salt water over time. I mean, the nitrogen cycle's the same, the bacteria is just a different name. You still gotta do your water changes if you're running it like me. Still gotta feed the fish, they eat a slightly different diet. Nothing's incredibly too different. The fish tend to be a little more expensive, and of course, doing your salt water changes can add up. But I mean, if you start with a 50 gallon tank, and you're doing a 10% water change once a week, or 20%, I mean, we're looking at what? $5 a water change, something like that.
Anyways, I don't expect you guys to run out and get a saltwater aquarium right now, but what I do expect in the coming months is for you to be more and more excited and inspired by this aquarium, and hopefully it serves a purpose and more of you guys get into saltwater tanks and or at least consider it.
And if you wanna see more of this tank, you're not subscribed to this channel yet, make sure you do, or, well, you're going to miss it. I still never came up with an outro. I have merch links in the description so you can get shirts that I wear in my videos. I know I never say that. I know I'm supposed to say that. I also wrote a book. Links in the description. I just assume people read the description. I'm not a good YouTuber. But I like it.